Well, welcome everyone. We're so excited to have you all join us, and I'm going to jump right in because I want to make sure we don't shortchange any of our great speakers this evening. So it's my tremendous privilege to have a chance to meet all of you virtually. I'm Rebecca Minter. I'm the chair of the Department of Surgery here at Wisconsin. And I'm excited today to talk to you and let you know a little bit more about our four great residency programs here. Oops. Sorry, I'm not a Mac person here. So I think before I jump right in and tell you about University of Wisconsin and about our programs, I think it's worth noting that this is extraordinary times, and we were all looking forward to meeting you all in person until this incredible little virus struck us all, and we now are finding that the whole world has changed around us. But I think we have also found that we have tremendous resilience, and this is a great picture of some of our incredible residents showing their muscles, and I think that we have all really learned over the last 5 months that we will persevere and that we are incredibly resilient and flexible in terms of figuring out how to move forward. And I think that it's also been a tremendous opportunity to remember why we all became physicians. And I think that really it's an incredibly exciting time to not only be in medicine, but to be embarking upon surgical residency. And that's because the other thing that we have all learned is how to be incredibly nimble in healthcare over the last 5 months. Fortunately, I didn't have to learn how to be nimble in this way, like my daughter practicing her gymnastics in our backyard. But we have all really jumped in and pushed forward innovations in healthcare that would have taken decades to have happened otherwise. And whether that's related to virtual healthcare or telehealth, the way that we take care of patients, it's all changing at a pace that really is unparalleled. And you all will be a part of defining how we deliver surgical care in the decades to come. And so I think it really is an exciting time. And as I've been reading a lot of John Lewis's writings lately, and it's been really inspirational. And I think that one of the things that has jumped out at me that I really believe is no matter what you read that John Lewis writes, he always comes back to the space of hope and optimism. And I think that I share that perspective. And I think that we are definitely going to move through all of this. And I know that we are going to match a great group of residents, and you all are going to find the perfect residency, even though we're doing it through a completely different way and learning how to do that together. So I think you all should feel very encouraged and know that we've gotten really good at virtual platforms in the last 5 months, and whether it's Wisconsin or the other programs that you all evaluate in the coming weeks, I think that you'll find that you'll be able to find the right place for you. So who are we, these Department of Surgery Badgers at Wisconsin? I'm going to provide a high-level overview, and then we're going to have the breakout session so you can learn more about our four different residencies. But these are eight vice chairs shown here. Globally within the department, we have a clear commitment to developing all of our residents, faculty, and staff. Comprehensively. You will be coming here to learn how to be a great general surgeon, vascular surgeon, otolaryngologist, plastic surgeon, but it's important to us that you also are developed as a leader, that we are developing our focus in diversity, equity, inclusion. We'll talk a little bit more about research quality, global surgery. You're going to hear from Dr. Tefera and Dr. Foley today. So we have really a tremendous team of leaders that helps lead each of those different areas. In the department, we have 11 divisions. These are our division chairs who are all fantastic leaders in their own right of great divisions and clinical clinical specialties, several of whom you'll have an opportunity to meet with tonight. I think importantly, one of the things that's very important to me, and I hope that all of my division chairs would attest to, is that collaboration and collegiality is one of our core values. And so we have a tremendously cohesive leadership group and a great opportunity to collaborate clinically, research, education across all 11 of our divisions. So who are we? We were fortunate to have finalized our strategic plan in January, right before COVID hit, but we found that this has really been a tremendous North Star for us as we move through these uncertain times. We aim to be the premier academic surgical department in North America, and I recognize that premier is defined in different ways to different people, and so that selection of that word was purposeful because, again, we hope to be tremendous in all of our missions. And I won't read all of this to you, but really our focus is on leveraging our inherent strengths, really building on an inclusive, collaborative, and connected culture, focusing on cross-disciplinary research, and really leveraging the expertise that we're fortunate to have here in competency-based training paradigms, and high-value patient-centered interdisciplinary clinical programs. We built our strategic plan on these five competencies, which are things that we are always committed to paying attention to all the time. They will not surprise you in terms of their focus. And then we really emphasized and highlighted four strategic domains, starting with culture. And even though culture should be considered a foundational competency, this was an area with respect to well-being and wellness, diversity, equity, inclusion, professional development that we wanted to have really some specific focus on in the next 5 years. And then you can see collaborative research, competency-based training, and interdisciplinary clinical programs. And I obviously don't have time to dive more deeply into the goals that underlay these different strategic domains, but I can tell you that we have residents who are attached to the strategic plan work groups in all four of these domains who are actively engaged in helping us define the future for the department. I do want to take a minute, though, to call out within our culture domain, particularly in light of the issues that we are currently facing with respect to structural racism in our country, that one of our key focuses is on enhancing our cultural competence and really promoting a sense of belonging and connection amongst all of the members of our department. And within that strategic plan and strategic domain work group, we've had a lot of tremendous engagement and work that's been ongoing within the department, and also within our health system. And so UW Health, which is our health system, also has committed to this work. And this is a board approved vision for where UW Health is headed with respect to dismantling racism. I think importantly, it's very important to us in the department and to our health system and medical school that this is not just yet another moment in time, but that we actually are putting forward actions that will have meaningful, be connected to meaningful change. And so this commitment from UW Health also came with a $1.5 million financial commitment in addition to existing commitments to do work in alignment with these three goals that are highlighted here. And so we are excited to partner with our health system in this work ahead. With respect to research, the department, we're really fortunate to have a broad array of all different types of research from basic and translational science and all different all of our specialties, as well as incredibly robust health services research, surgical education research, global surgery, and our residents interface with every aspect of our research program. We also have a tremendous research infrastructure in the department with respect to biostats support, grants management, clinical trials that our residents are able to leverage. We are ranked eighth in the country currently as a department of surgery and have a total $18 million of annual research funding. This is the NIH Blue Ridge rankings shown here. with respect to our residents, we have more training grants than any Department of Surgery in the country that we are aware of, which we are very proud of, stretching from surgical oncology, transplant, vascular surgery, and voice. And the program directors of each of those training grants are shown here. Many of our residents spend 2 years doing research as postdoctoral fellows on our training grants. And we also have, of course, postdoctoral trainees that come from other places as well. And wanted to just give a bit of a highlight on our health services research enterprise, WISOR, as it's called, the Wisconsin Surgical Outcomes Research Program. And Kareen Voiles, David Francis, and Lori Silverberg lead WISOR. We have many faculty who are connected to WISOR, and many of our residents are fellows in WISOR across all of our residency programs. So Dr. Francis is the associate director, is an otolaryngologist, and many of our, we have our vascular surgeons, plastic surgeons, and general surgeons who all are part of WISOR, as well as some individuals from other departments like urology. We are fortunate to have particular expertise and passion around competency-based training paradigms. My scholarship focus has actually been in education and in growing and better understanding competency-based training. I love this figure that we have used as a symbol of our work, that really was something that our residents brought to us, which was we were trying to come up with a symbol for our work around OpTrust, and we had a picture of a scalpel here being handed off, and the resident said, no, I know I'm trusted when you hand me the right angle and let me do the dissection, not when you hand me the scalpel or the Bovie. And I think that's exactly what we aim for, is that at the end of training is that all of our residents are the ones driving the right angle rather than the faculty. And so we are very invested in, this is just one tool, a tool that we've developed called OpTrust, which really focuses on entrustment and entrustability behaviors for faculty and residents to help them develop and become more independent and autonomous at an earlier rate. Likewise, we're very engaged in the entrustment professional activities, activity that's happening through the American Board of Surgery, and then unique expertise and coaching. And so again, bringing all of these unique experts to bear on our training programs. Lastly, and I'm not going to touch on all of the different cases and specifics of our training programs, our program directors will do that, but we have a number of facilities where the residents will train. This is our campus that has University Hospital, the Children's Hospital, the VA, all right on the shores of Lake Mendota. The Children's Hospital is one of these facilities. Over on the east side, we also have the American Center, which is a brand new facility built 5 years ago. For those of you who are sports fanatics, it has a complete replica of the basketball court and football court and indoor track for those of you who would like to work out when you're over at the American Center for rotations. And then Unity Point Meritor is a UW Health facility. It's about 3.5 miles from the main campus on Lake Mendota, which is also about a 400 bed hospital of UW Health, where many of our residents rotate on all of our specialties. Our patients come from across the country, as shown here. And we, again, have many interdisciplinary clinical programs that draw patients from around the world. So the key takeaways I'd like to leave with you tonight is that, from my perspective, recruiting and training the next generation of surgical leaders and surgeons is the most important thing we do. It touches every mission and amplifies them. You all are the ones in the emergency room seeing the patients and calling us. You're leading, helping drive our research programs forward. So it's really critical to us to recruit the right folks. And by that, we are looking for a diverse group, diverse defined very broadly. By that, we mean individuals who are going to bring diverse perspectives to join our already talented group of residents and team, and to really help strengthen and define who we will become. And so we're not looking for people who are going to be just like us. We're interested in finding people who will bring new and diverse perspectives. And lastly, your success is our success. Please reach out, ask us questions. We understand this is a very unusual year. We are all here and available to answer any questions that you may have. So with that, I will turn things over on Wisconsin.
Great. Terrific. Well, I'm Chip Foley, and I have the privilege of serving the department as the Vice Chair of Education and being the leader of our Division of Education in our department. And I wanted to join Rebecca and the other faculty in welcoming all of you and thanking you for your interest in our programs. The Division of Education really covers a broad range of significant educational activities throughout the department. And as you can imagine, it covers our UME, our medical student education, our GME, our residencies and fellowships, of which you're the most interested presently. But also we have a wide range of CME activity for those practitioners who are in our community and elsewhere who have finished their formal training. And also, as Rebecca mentioned, we have a robust section in the Division of Education around our efforts in education research and global health. And you're going to hear a little bit more about the global health program from Dr. DeFerre in a minute. If you think about our efforts in GME, we have a big, very diverse GME program. We have four residencies, the four residencies that you are interested in applying this year in general surgery, vascular plastics, and otolaryngology. And you'll hear a little bit more in detail about those residencies from our program directors in the second half hour. We also have 10 fellowships across our department in transplant, vascular, cardiothoracic, ENT, with the head and neck oncology fellowship and a laryngology fellowship, as well as fellowships in some of the disciplines within general surgery, colorectal surgery, MIS, surgeon, endocrine, and critical care. During my tenure as the program director for the general surgery residency training program, one of our big initiatives, or really big priorities, was to try to figure out the best way of integrating all of these 14 training programs amongst themselves and together to get the most training we can for all of our trainees, independent of which program that they're in. One of the nice and unique features about this department is that, unlike other departments of surgery, our vascular program, our cardiothoracic division, our otolaryngology division, our plastic surgery divisions are all part of the Department of Surgery. In many places, those sections or those specialties are separate departments. And I think one of the great advantages of that is it's allowed us in a much more effective way to integrate all of these training programs. And I think we have a fantastic relationship between the divisions and these different programs, to the betterment of all of our trainees, independent of which program that they're in. Let's see if I can move forward here. As Rebecca was alluding to, we have a very big department. There's over 140 faculty scattered across 11 divisions. We operate primarily in four major clinical facilities. The University Hospital, which is probably very similar to university hospitals that many of you are training as medical students, which provides both what I would call primary surgical care for our community, but also serves as a tertiary and quaternary referral center for a very large geographic area in the northern Midwest. Additionally, we have a fantastic VA system that's physically attached to our main university hospital. For those of you who've had the opportunity as students to train in the VA, having a VA experience is also a wonderful opportunity to develop clinically, and we have a very strong and robust VA experience at the Milton VA on our campus. We also have great fortune of having a very close relationship with the Mariner Unity Point Hospital, which is a large community-based hospital, which provides primary surgical care to our community, and our residents in all specialties rotate there. And finally, the American Center, which is on the east side, that was built 4 or 5 years ago, which is a primary surgical hospital. Some of our specialties in our department, including endocrine surgery and minimally invasive surgery, do most of their work there. In addition to those clinical facilities, we also have a number of other resources here to help train all of our residents and fellows. The university hospital has put their money where their mouth is, such as it is, in terms of putting together a significant amount of resource building, a state-of-the-art simulation center, which is right in the hospital, right along the, right off the main elevator in the hospital, easily accessible center where we do much of our simulation training. Despite the budgetary constraints around COVID that have occurred in the last year, that the hospital has doubled down, such as it is, on their commitment to simulation, and there's a big renovation and additions going on to increase our ability to provide simulation for our trainees there. The residents also enjoy significant administrative resources. Mallory Zink, who's on the call today, is the manager of all of our GME programs, and she is assisted in that effort by 5 program coordinators and a number of divisional administrators who are there to support our trainees and our programs. Rebecca mentioned that we have significant departmental and organizational support for residents in terms of developing their academic research careers and skills. We have 4 T32 training spots with 12 spots per year in them across a number of specialties, multiple funded NIH labs, the WISER, which is the Wisconsin Center for Surgical Outcomes Research. We have an education research fellowship. One of our general surgery residents, Chris Stahl, is doing that fellowship. We have significant support in terms of academic travel, statistical and editing support, and academic mentoring. And so we have a unique opportunity here, not only to provide you with outstanding clinical exposure and training, but also significant resources to support your development academically. So my answer to the question, why Wisconsin? I think all of you probably appropriately at this point in your process of looking for residencies, probably your number one priority is to look for a place and find a place in which you will receive outstanding clinical training. And I can say this without any equivocation, that all of our residents and all 4 of our programs, based on the very broad, deep clinical programs in all of our specialties, all of our residents will finish their training in these residencies well equipped to go on to whatever they want to do. If you finished our residency and wanted to go into the practice of surgery, you'd be perfectly capable of doing so based on the experiences you've had. But our residents are also well positioned to be competitive and to be successful in any sort of subspecialty fellowship training that they would be interested in beyond their residency. But in addition to that, we really, I think, offer our trainees a lot more than that. There's an expectation and an opportunity to participate and develop academically during your time here, beyond your clinical training, in a number of different areas, in education, to improve and develop your skills as a teacher, if that ultimately is a significant career goal for you, and in research, as we are mentioning. The other thing I'd like to mention too, which I think is a high priority for us, and I think Rebecca touched on this a little bit, is the following, that I think no matter what our residents or our trainees end up doing in their careers, one of the things that we really would value and really want our trainees to be able to do is be leaders wherever they are. And if they're in community practice, to be leaders in their community in terms of their healthcare system and the specialty of surgery. And I think that's really important to us. And I think particularly with Rebecca's addition to our department, I think that's become an explicit priority of this department and our division of education, our training programs. And as such, if you came here, there would be both informal as well as formal mentorship in terms of developing your skills as a leader, and specific curriculum around training and leadership, as we think that that's a very a big priority for us. The other thing I think that makes Wisconsin special or different is, in addition to all those things, and again, with Rebecca's leadership, built on a history of value and prioritization around developing a collegial work environment in which we are all committed to work hard, but also committed to take care of one another, and to make sure all of us stay healthy and work in a pleasant collegial environment. And I think that that's also a unique thing about Wisconsin as part of the world that makes this a special place. And finally, just a pitch for Madison, it's a fantastic place to live. And so those are a few of the things that lead me to, or my answers to why you should look at a place, you know, as why you should look at training in Wisconsin. It's a fantastic place that will train you in any sort of way, technically and academically, and also just a really wonderful supportive environment in which to work. So I'd now like to turn it over to Gurmit Tafera, who is our vice chair and leader for our global health initiatives and programs, to tell you a little bit about the global health program we have. Get Gurmit on there.
I am here. I'm trying to share.
Well, let me stop sharing mine. There you go.
Yeah.
Have I done it? Good.
Oh, yeah, you did. So, can you see my screen now? Yes, okay, perfect. Thank you. Thank you, Chip. Thank you, Rebecca, for giving me the opportunity to say a few words to this amazing, you know, group of students. I just want to raise a little bit more their knowledge base and the, you know, make them aware a little bit about, you know, what we do in terms of global health initiatives. But I just really want to start by, you know, maybe first, you know, inviting them to read a little bit more about Wisconsin. So Wisconsin is really a special place from thinking from within, sharing knowledge, going out outside of the classroom and going into the communities and making sure people outside are taken care of. And this outreach effort is really a philosophy that the university had for 100 years now. And this has basically extended beyond beyond the state to the country and now to the world. So it is really a bigger deal for Wisconsin to really have this notion and this philosophy of reaching out and going and providing service throughout the world and making sure we get out of the boundaries of our classrooms and share our knowledge. So with that, I think what we really want to achieve, you know, in you or in the residency program, in the trainees that come through us, is really to get them to become ultimately global citizens. Ultimately, people who are, you know, trained and leaders in surgery, but most importantly, with a lot more deeper knowledge of the world that we live in. This world is really small. This world is 8 hours away if you want to really see it all. And so we cannot live in isolation, and it's really, really important, therefore, to think about in totality, to think about being part of the world rather than being isolated or living in a very limited boundaries. So that said, I also am fully aware that that probably in this day and age, maybe up to 70-80% of medical students and also residents who are junior residents or interns probably had already some global health experiences. And so this is something we would really love to further enrich it and build it and provide it in a very educationally sound manner so that we can hopefully work towards this building this competent surgeons who are actually world leaders. Think about 80 to 90% of the world population lives elsewhere, and they live in low resource settings. And that is where innovation is going to happen. And so I think it's really important for us as US citizens, as those who are in this higher level of educational activities, research, to really be engaged in that environment so that we can really be the creators, the inventors of the solutions that not only help and support the low resource places, but actually it can also be important for us back here in our own home country, where we call it a reverse innovation. And so we want to really achieve this fundamental goal, where we want to have surgeons who are competent, who are aware and respectful of cultural differences, and think about how important that is even now in this country, in this environment where we are in. And so the goals are very clear, and we have been doing this for many years. This is a slide that our chair shared with me yesterday, and it was, you know, it really is such a nice slide where it shows all the places where we are actively engaged, and all the divisions are engaged. Of course, you know, some divisions have been there much longer than others, particularly the plastic surgery program has been doing this for a very, very long period of time. But you can see almost all the continents are involved here. We have Ethiopia, we have Thailand, Honduras, Egypt, and so on and so forth. And these are actually partnerships and relationships. It's not go and do something good. It's actually go and build partnership, relationship, friendship, and actually share what you have, learn. And it's not, you know, we want to go and teach, but we also want to go and learn and come back and do good. And so it is beyond that feel good kind of activity. It's actually much deeper, and this relationship and partnerships are very solid and long lasting. I really do think the ultimate testimony to what we do are the residents. And when you look at what the residents say after whatever long or short period of time they have been abroad, it is just incredible the message we get from them. And here is, for example, Julie, who says that it has changed my outlook in many things in life and ignited love for global health. And the, you know, the inspiration that Shruti mentions here, by the motivation, the perseverance, generosity, and the spirit that she sees in workers in low-income countries is amazing. And those kind of deep feelings that our students and residents actually tell us, you know, is something very clear message that what we do is the right thing, and what we are, you know, providing to our residents, these experiences, how long or short they might be, is incredible. And in fact, we have probably the only vascular surgery outreach program with Global Health Outreach, which is just, yes, as a division chair for vascular surgery, I just want to plug that in as well. But this is actually something that will take off. And I think in many places will, you know, think global health is only general surgery. No, it is not. Patients are there of all sorts. Cancer is the biggest plague actually in the rest of the world. And as vascular surgery is, as thoracic surgery is. And so we have an amazing opportunity. We want to be that conduit to open up those doors. And so in that why Wisconsin, probably the answer will be, we just want to open the door and the window. Maybe we can together see the rest of the world so that we can make you a global citizen, a very competent surgeon that has the world perspective and culturally aware and is feeling part of the world in general. So it's very easy to reach out to me. I have my university email here. I have seen already some familiar faces among the students from some of the global health interactions. And most of you probably know that I work at also at the American College of Surgeons in the Global Health Program, which really links very well with what we do here. And I am looking forward to hearing from all of you or most of you. If you have any questions, then please feel free to email me or contact me through the office number whenever possible. So with that, thank you very much for the opportunity to talk with you and for you being on this call today. I'm looking forward to seeing you in the future. Thank you.